She is the mind-born daughter of Brahma, the creator. Lord Shiva gave her as a gift to sage Agastya, who made her flow on earth. Lord Vishnu rewarded her penance and made her a holy river. The sacred Cauvery represents the holy trinity of Hinduism, creating, sustaining, and destroying as she flows. It is the month of April, and the summer in India is harsh. Life all along the Cauvery looks at her dry bed for water. The Cauvery looks up at the sky for water. Far away in the Pacific Ocean, a phenomenon called El Niño and its opposite La Niña work alternately to warm and cool the ocean currents. This will decide the intensity of the monsoon rains in this part of the planet. High up in the mountains of the Western Ghats in Coorg, Tala Cauvery is the holy source of Cauvery. Every year, on an auspicious day and time, the Cauvery surges from its source with renewed vigor. This is the day of the Cauvery Sankramana. The spring then mysteriously disappears between rocks. It is believed by the faithful that the river goes underground and emerges at Bhagamandala. As June arrives, dark clouds of the southwest monsoon blanket the mountains of Coorg. The first drops of the monsoon rain start falling. Life begins again. The land you tread is Karnataka. The water you drink is Cauvery. Like all rain-fed rivers, the source of the Cauvery is the rains on the hills. The Tala Cauvery Wildlife Sanctuary covers more than 100 square kilometers, and several streams drain down to swell the Cauvery as she emerges from the lush forests near Bhagamandala. This beautiful little village is the abode of Lord Shiva as Bhagandeshwara. Just outside the temple is the Triveni Sangama, the confluence of three rivers, Cauvery, Kanike, and the mythical Sujyoti. Thank you. Mandala is surrounded by forests, estates and orchards and is famous for its honey. The Cauvery now starts her long journey across a glorious country where life and prosperity depend on her flowing waters. Coffee and spices are the lifeline here, and the Cauvery flows through forests, straggling bamboos, estates, fields, and meadows, weaving an inseparable relationship with the people of Kodagu, the Kodavas. The Kodavas are well known for their valor and follow unique customs. Cauvery is their hereditary goddess, and they believe they are her children. Everything they have has been provided by their mother, Cauvery. As a poet beautifully puts it, in Coorg, the Cauvery is like a brilliant lightning among the clouds. In ancient times, huge herds of elephants roamed thick and wild in these lands. Hunting elephants for their ivory and catching them in kedars was the favorite pastime of the royals in those days. The elephant camp at Dubare provides recreation to visitors who come to play with them and go rafting in the flowing moods of the Cauvery. The rains swell or subdue the Cauvery in her flow as she reaches Kushalnagar. The Namjoling Nyingmapa Monastery here is the largest teaching center of the Nyingma lineage of Tibetan Buddhism in the world. Inside is the Padmasambhava Buddhist Vihara, known as the Golden Temple. The Cauvery now turns north, and the Haringi River, which drains another side of the Coorg Hills, comes down to join her near the villages of Kudige and Kanive. Irrigation canals from the Haringi Dam spread out to a length of nearly 300 kilometers and serve the agricultural needs of more than 135,000 acres of land. Near the northernmost reaches of the Cauvery, about 800 years ago, a stunning dam was built with boulders by saints to help in irrigation and fishing. This amazing structure at Kattepura still remains. At Konanur, the Cauvery turns to start her journey south, and the great epic of Ramayana comes to merge with her at Ramnathpura. Rama is believed to have worshipped Lord Shiva here after his victory to seek salvation from the curse of killing Ravana in far away Sri Lanka. This stretch of Cauvery is today a fish sanctuary. This is also said to be the land where Rama, Lakshmana and Sita spent some time during their exile in the wilderness. Sita is believed to have frolicked in the waters of the Cauvery at Chunchunkatte. Crossing Chunchunkatte, a seemingly slow but swift flowing Cauvery sanctifies pilgrims at the Shiva temple at Kapadi. In the early 1920s, the Cauvery flooded and completely damaged an old village called Yedathore. The 12th century temple for Lord Arkeshwara continues to stand on her banks as a witness to her ever-changing moods. A new town, Krishnarajanagara, was created at a higher elevation. This is one of the most important regions of rice cultivation in Karnataka. Green fields everywhere, the sound of the flowing river and crops dancing in the breeze present a picture of peace and plenty. The Cauvery continues to breach her banks all around as the rains come down with fury. The Cauvery now enters the largest water reservoir in Karnataka. While she rests in here, before continuing her journey, the Hemavati River, originating in the hills of Chikmagalur district, joins in, bringing along with her the faith of Jainism. Shravana Belagola on the banks of the Hemavati is home to over 2,300 years of Jain heritage. About 800 inscriptions dating back from 600 CE have been found in these hills. The texts, many in ancient Kannada, have helped to understand the nature and evolution of the Kannada language. Built around 983 CE, the colossal monolith statue of Bahubali as Lord Gomateshwara is the largest freestanding statue in the world. Jainism is believed to have spread around the Cauvery Basin from here. In the year 1911, a renowned engineer, M. Vishweshwaraya, started the project to dam the Cauvery in these wide open lands to harness, control, and use her waters for agriculture and electricity. The Krishnarajasagara Dam, completed in 1932, is more than 2.5 kilometers long and can hold up to 47,000 million cubic feet of water. The bounty from these rich lands irrigated by the Cauvery can be seen everywhere as you travel around here. Below this dam is the spectacular Vrindavan Gardens, created by Mirza Ismail, the then Diwan of Mysore. This terraced garden, with its illuminated fountains, flowering plants, trees, lawns, boating, and a musical fountain, is a sight to behold. ...70 kilometers south of Talakaveri, in the same range of hills, is the source of the Lakshmana Tirtha River. On its course is the Irupu Falls. Legend has it that the river was created by an arrow from Lakshmana's bow to provide water for a thirsty Rama. This river joins the Cauvery at Krishnarajasagara. The wild Cauvery has now met her first obstacle, and a controlled flow starts, providing beautiful picnic spots. The Ranganathittu Bird Sanctuary on her banks near Mysore is a haven for more than 150 species of wildlife. Mysore and the Cauvery are bound together inseparably by geography, history, culture, and life. The temple of Chamundeshwari in Chamundi Hills takes you back through ages to the legend of the killing of the Asura Mahisha and his army. The oldest temple on this hill is that of Lord Mahabaleshwara, built around 1000 CE by the Ganga dynasty. The palace of the Vodayar kings in Mysore is the central landmark of this ancient city. The Vodayars were feudatory chiefs under the Vijayanagara Empire and great patrons of the arts, music, dance, and culture that flourished along the banks of Cauvery. "Thrice you shall part, and I will recline on your laps," said Lord Vishnu to Cauvery. His first abode is the island of Srirangapatna near Mysore, Adirangam. Cauvery is believed to have prayed to Lord Vishnu here at Srirangapatna to receive a status holier than Ganga. Goddess Mahalakshmi then took a holy dip in the Cauvery and joined him as Ranganayaki. This natural island created by the Cauvery has a long history of religion, royalty, war, and suffering. Around the 15th century CE, an elite group of Arabs called Navyats set out from Arabia and landed in India. They were the antecedents of Hyder Ali. He settled in Srirangapatna and joined the army of the Wodeyars. He went on to rise to the level of controlling them and ruling their kingdom. His son, Tipu Sultan, would go on to strike terror in the hearts of people living even in faraway lands. Srirangapatna was Tipu Sultan's capital till his death in 1799. The Cauvery played a role in his life and death. Right from Coorg, he has crossed and recrossed the Cauvery many times, campaigning along her banks. It was while fighting the British here that he met his end. In his fort, he stood anticipating the British to come from the north by crossing the Cauvery. But the Britishers crossed the Cauvery near Sosile and reached the island, crossing her again over the southern branch. In the ensuing battle, Tipu Sultan was shot and killed. His body was found the next day. His tomb is near the southern tip of Srirangapatna, along with his mother and father. The plunder and looting that followed was of colossal proportions. Almost every museum and private collection throughout the British Isles have a part of the treasure from Srirangapatna, including Tipu Sultan's famous Tiger Throne. An unperturbed Cauvery, unmindful of the greed and desires of mere human beings, meets herself again, a little way down at the Sangam.